drum roll. It's time now to reveal our mystery guest. He's an all-time fan favorite here in Philadelphia who captained the Carolina Hurricanes to their first ever Stanley Cup. Now he's behind the bench for the Canes, a team battling for the top spot in the Central Division this season. And he was kind enough to chat with us via Zoom, of course, yesterday. And I can only be talking about Rod Brind'Amour. Here's number 17 on his time in Philadelphia, his legendarily intense workouts, and navigating this unique season.
Under all the circumstances, everybody's playing under just kind of craziness, really. But give the guys a lot of credit. They've come to work every day and just played hard every night. And you know, we've had some you know, games didn't go our way, but never from a lack of effort or anything. So it's all about this group of players. You know, we're in a good position because of what they bring every night.
How do you feel like you've been able to get the best out of your players? We've seen how this unique season has impacted different teams in different ways. Some teams seem like they've really stepped up to the challenge and other teams have struggled with it. But it seems like, I mean, the Hurricanes are obviously exceeding expectations. And I feel like every night that I tune in and look around the National Hockey League, they're talking about this Canes player, you know, sliding under the radar, having a really strong season, but you can only slide under the radar so long before you're truly a contender here.
Well, we're not exceeding our expectations, and that's the most important thing. So, you know, we expect to win every night, and that's what I love about the group too, is they really believe it, and they should. You know, we have a lot of good young players. We got great leadership, and I think can't be understated. You know, when your top guys or your Jordan Stahls of the world come in and they handle themselves the way they do, it's just a trickle-down effect. And it's been great to be part of and watch how it's kind of developed over the last couple of years.
What has this year been like for you in terms of the schedule and the format? We're used to obviously seeing the Hurricanes heading down to Raleigh a whole handful of times in a season. And now you guys are out there in the Central, packed in with a whole slew of teams that wouldn't normally be on your schedule as much as they are right now.
Yeah, it's interesting, right? I mean, I think it was good at first just to be in places that we don't normally go to and playing teams that were kind of, like you said, not that we normally play, but now it's kind of getting old, I'll be honest. But it's also intense, right? It feel like there's some kind of, not rivalries necessarily, but you can tell the guys out there hating each other, and which I think breeds the probably pretty competitive hockey. And so that probably is good. But it is, you know what, at the end of the day, we're just happy to be playing. And I think that's the sentiment. I mean, whatever we got to do to have that opportunity, that's how our guys approach it. And I think you got to give the league in general, the players, a ton of credit for how they've handled all this. You know, you watch the games, I think they play hard. And with no fans, for the most part, like, this sport is meant to be played in front of fans, that emotion. And you take that out of it, it's hard. But these guys, and I don't just mean my team. I mean, every team that I watch, they play hard. And I think that's, you know, that says a lot about the players.
What's the biggest adjustment you feel like you've had to make as a coach, or you've had to watch your players make as a team to, you know, not feel the redundancy of the opponents, let it seep into their game, and not let the quiet arenas impact them?
Yeah, it's a great question. I think it's really comes down to the players and their preparation and just understanding that, you know, whether there's 18, 20,000 or none, you still have a job to do, and you got to go and do your job. I mean, you're lucky to have the job, so you better go and do it, you know, regardless. And when the fans start coming back, and we've seen some now, you know, we had, I don't know how many, a few thousand now, and it feels like 20. Like, and it's great. It's that emotion, you can start feeling it. And I can only, you know, hope that we get through better days where the buildings are packed. But in the meantime, go do your job.
Off the ice, obviously making some news, you announced that a few of your players were able to get the first dose of the vaccine. It's something that you, as a team, have kind of publicly come out and said you thought was important. How much did that mean to you to say to people, hey, we're taking this step, we want to take this step?
Well, there's a bigger, you know, picture question and more important one probably. And I think it's super important. You know, I think you got to do your part. Otherwise, we're going to be dealing with this longer and longer. And I think, you know, the main message really is do your part. And if you have that opportunity, like some of our players have been afforded now, I think it's great. And, you know, real grateful to the people that have put this on, all the behind the scenes people that are, you know, made this possible. I mean, it's incredible. And what we're doing is a small part.
while we've got you, we can't help but ask some Philly questions, some Philadelphia Flyer questions. How do you think your time in Philadelphia, obviously you're here for quite a while, shaped the player you became, the captain you became, and now the coach that you are?
Man, that's such a good question, because I can't give enough credit to my time there as it developed me as just as overall the way I approached my game, you know, getting there. And then, you know, my first meeting with Paul Holmgren and going, oh, wow, you know, this is okay. I get it. And then becoming friends with Bill Barber, you know, him taking me under my wing. I mean, I can go on and on, right? I could talk all day about it. It was such a great time for me. And then go into the Spectrum and then have the fans like say, hey, you better play right. You know, that's essentially what they did. And I said, oh, okay, you know, don't worry, I'm going to try. Like, I think it was just, it was great. You know, I love my time there. Everyone knows that I've said that. It was the worst day of my life, probably when I got traded out of there, but it's all worked out. Like for me, obviously but I can never say enough good things about my time there, the organization, and more importantly, the fans, incredible Philadelphia Flyer fans.
You mentioned the fans at the Spectrum. I feel like when it comes to Philly sports, fans oftentimes are the first thing that come to mind when they think about Philadelphia sports, which is unique. I'm curious because you guys have developed a really cool fan base down in Raleigh with the Storm Surge and all of the community involvement there. But what makes Philly sports fans so unique as a guy who's, you know, obviously played everywhere in the league as a member of the NHL?
Well, they care. You know, they care, man, that they're not just there to show up and, you know, watch a game or get a free ticket. And no, man, they're invested, you know, and that's what I loved about it. They kept you on your toes. Like if you had a bad shift, like, you know, hey, they let you know, hey, come on, that's not good enough. But I'll tell you right now, when you've had a good shift or you had a good game, they're the first ones to pat you on the back and tell you good job. And I thrived in that environment. I loved it. And, you know, what's different down here is we have a great thing going with our fans because the players get it. The players here understand that it's a give and take, and we have a good relationship with our fans. And the Surge thing, that's just for the fans and the players. Like, that's been great. And so we have a community feel down here. It's a little different than maybe some other big markets, but our players understand it, and they have their own little relationship going here with our group and our fans, and, you know, it works.
What's the memory when you think back of your time about the Flyers, or the few memories that stand out to you still, the first things that come to mind? I know there's a lot for you.
There's so much. I I got so lucky, you know, to be there at a good time. You know, I was young and we were a young team and we were kind of just starting up. So I would say I got a great opportunity to play in an all-star game in front of the fans there. And I'll tell this quick story. I don't know how much time, you probably edited it out.
Oh, tell all the stories, Rod. Tell all the stories.
It's, you know, I'd only been there about 20 games. Because you think about it, the all-star game was halfway through the year. I played 20 games. I'm a nobody. And I got the loudest ovation over Wayne Gretzky, Mario Lemieux, all these people in the – and not because I was Rod Brind'Amour. Who is he? It's because I wore a Flyer jersey. And they knew. And they were not going to let me feel, you know – beneath any of these other guys. And I'll remember that still sitting right now. I get goosebumps thinking about it when I skated out and how the place just erupted. And it wasn't, they didn't know who I was probably still, but they knew I was a Flyer, and that meant a lot to me, you know? And so that's a huge memory. The teams we had there, obviously we had some great teams. One of my biggest regrets is not winning a championship there, because we were a championship team and we just didn't give enough time, I think, to keep that all together. But, you know, certainly no regrets, really. It is awesome. Awesome time.
It's interesting because we've talked to Mark Recchi and Rick Tocchet, and they've all said that same exact thing. One of their biggest regrets when they look back their NHL career, given how much love Philly has for their athletes, they couldn't bring a cup back to those kinds of fans.
So true. So true. And that's why, I mean, I was fortunate enough to win one here, and I'm so grateful for it, because it's really a special. It's a give back too. I mean, we take a lot out of it, but it's a give back to all these people that come every night and support you.
I'd be remiss if I didn't ask, because every single guy that I work with who played with you brings up your workouts, your legendary workouts back in the day. And even now you read about your player saying, like, we see this guy hit the gym this hard and we feel like we have to go hit the gym even harder. What does Rod Brind'Amour's COVID workout regimen looks like right now?
I know Keith Jones didn't say that he was in there working out with me, so I know you didn't.
Oh, no, he didn't claim it. He didn't claim it, but he was like, you got to go ask Rod about his workouts.
He might have walked by a few times the gym. You know what? It's just part of kind of – I think it's a part of everyone's healthy life. I mean, get in there, do something. And so for me, it's just every day – it's a refresher, gets my mind going. I feel like get a good sweat, and then I can start my day and be the best I can be. That's it. What does it look like? It's not like it used to. I mean, I'm definitely on more of an executive workout schedule as far as how hard I'm going, but I still think you try to do it every day, and that's the secret.
Jonesy told me he used to roll up and you'd be done getting ready to go to practice, having already worked out, and he was wiping sleepies out of his eyes trying to fix his hair or something.
Or spraying the water bottle on his face and making him look like he'd done something. He's still pulling it off, so good for him.
Oh, good for him. Every time we do one of these, somehow it ends up being a Jonesy chirp fest. So, Rod, we thank you for keeping it going here today.
All right. Well, you're welcome.
A good one, Rod. Good luck.
All right. Take care. Thank you.
Coming up on Flyers Pregame Live, driven by AAA, Jonesy joins us. We will give him ample opportunity to respond to Brindy's outrageous claims, and we are going on ice live. That's after this break.